question of the Feynman equation. We were dealing with the various components of this equation, and we had looked at was the vapor pressure deficit, was the weightage factors, was the wind function. The only thing which is left is the net radiation. So we'll start today with the net radiation. To start with, let's see, what do we mean by the net radiation? Net radiation is the difference between all the incoming and outgoing radiation with respect to the Earth, because this is the source. This is the source of the energy which is responsible for the evapotranspiration activity. If you look at this figure, this gives the various components of, so the source is the sun here, which is the source of the radiation. And we have already seen that some part of this radiation reaches the ground surface. But before the atmosphere, a part which is reaching the atmosphere, which is known as the extraterrestrial radiation, which we had expressed by RA, that is something which is fixed, which remains same as long as we are looking at the same period in the year and we are concerned with the same coordinates on the Earth. So when we are looking from a particular point on the Earth and for a particular location, in other words, and also for a particular duration of the year, the amount of RA, the extraterrestrial radiation, will remain same. That is a unique quantity. But what happens when this RA, it approaches towards the Earth? Some part of this radiation gets absorbed in the atmosphere. Some part of that gets scattered. So the part which gets scattered is accounted for in terms of the RS. RS was the radiation reaching the surface. Now this RS is the shortwave radiation which is reaching the Earth's surface. A part of this RS, a part of this shortwave radiation is reflected back into the atmosphere, and this reflection, how much will be reflected back into the atmosphere, is a function of this quantity alpha. This alpha here, which we have mentioned, the alpha part of RS goes back into the atmosphere or gets reflected into the atmosphere from the surfaces on which the RS impinges. So it depends on what is the surface which is encountered on the Earth. Was it a water body or was it a cropped area on which the radiation RS impinged upon? Depending on that, and depending on the properties of that surface, this alpha will be dependent, and this alpha is known as albedo. You must have heard this term in some course earlier in your undergraduate curriculum. This albedo is the alpha which decides, which depends on the reflecting properties of the surface on which this RS impinges. For example, if we compare the alpha value, the reflection coefficient will be something to the tune of around 8 or so for water bodies, whereas is up to around 25 for the crop areas. There's a level difference. That means if you are having a crop area, it will be able to absorb, it will be able to absorb less radiation in the soil. More of this will be getting scattered or getting reflected into the atmosphere. That is how you can find out what is the net shortwave radiation. So what is net shortwave radiation? The net shortwave radiation, R and S we are designating it as RS to 1 minus alpha. That is what is retained. Similarly, the other component, we come back to this sketch. There's another component which is the long wave radiation. Now, this long wave radiation as a function of what is the status of the atmosphere and what is the status of the Earth's surface. There is some long wave radiation which is coming from the atmosphere into the soil, and there is some component which goes from the soil into the atmosphere, and that will depend on the gradient, that will depend on the flux, what is the flux, what are the conditions of the Earth with respect to the atmosphere, and that is what is accounted for here in the form of this, the net long wave radiation. This is incoming from the atmosphere into the Earth's surface, whereas there is some part which is going out. Now the net effect, if it is negative, in other words, if the outgoing is more than the incoming, and in general, you will find that the outgoing long wave radiation is much higher than the incoming long wave radiation. That's the reason that in the end analysis, if we look at the net radiation, that is the difference between the net long wave and the net short wave. Since net long wave is the one which is being lost from the Earth, that's why we are given a negative symbol to this, or the sign allotted is the sign here is the minus sign. So the net radiation is the difference between the net short wave radiation and the net long wave radiation. Let's look at the various data which will be involved when you like to compute what is the net radiation which is available at a particular location. We have already seen this specific relationship where you are relating the solar radiation which is reaching the Earth's surface in terms of the extraterrestrial radiation and as a function of the N by N ratio. So since N by N is the major factor which is influencing how much radiation will be absorbed in the atmosphere, RS is a function of these two major parameters. Once you have the RS available, then the next step is to obtain the net shortwave radiation, which we have said that is dependent on the albedo, is dependent on the reflective properties of the surface on which the solar radiation is oncoming. And there is And in general, this alpha for most of the cropped areas is 0.25, is 25%, what I was mentioning. And since we are, when we are computing the evapotranspiration from the crop areas, we can ensure that most of the time we are interested in those surfaces where the crop areas are there. Otherwise, if you are using this equation for some other areas, which are either populated areas or urban areas or water bodies, then you can choose appropriate alpha value. So this table, with that assumption that alpha is 0.25, there's a relationship which is available, and you can find out what is the conversion factor which has to be used, and knowing the RA, you can directly find out what is the value of RNS, which is equal to 1 minus alpha into RS. So that table can directly give you the conversion factor which has to be used for alpha is equal to 0.25. Then the next is, once you have the RNS, the only other element is RNL to find out the net radiation. And RNL is the long wave radiation, which is dependent on many other climatic factors. And it has been found that these three elements, the temperature, the vapor pressure, and the N by N ratio, these are the three elements which influence RNL the maximum. So RNL is found out in terms of these three elements, or these three factors have been obtained. And FU, the way they have suggested this modified Penman equation, they have converted all those different influencing factors in terms of tables. You can read directly what is the value of FT, what is the value of the ED, and the N by N. And once you have those values, you can directly obtain the RNN value. Let me show, there is the other method also which you can use if you don't have these tables available. But let's first have a look, because these tables are giving a procedure which is much simplified. On this particular case, this is our table which is giving the effect of temperature on the long wave radiation. Because how much goes back into the atmosphere is a function of temperature. So that is the first factor. And this table, once you know the temperature, you have been given a function which is dependent on T, and that value is available here for different temperatures ranging from 0 to 36. You can read the corresponding value of the FT, which in turn is dependent on the temperature, which is in Kelvin, and a constant sigma which is available. Similarly, the other functions are also, they're also available. The function which is giving the variation of FED, which is dependent on the vapor pressure, the prevailing vapor pressure, is given in this particular table, where you have the vapor pressure in millibars, and this function is, this is the expression used for this particular function, 0.34 minus 0.044 under the root ED. And for these values of vapor pressure, you can read the corresponding value of the FED. And in the same manner, the other quantity and the N ratio also, there's a relationship which has been made available. So once you have the N by N ratio, and we know that N is something which is constant for that location and that far for that particular duration, N is something which can be observed, that we already looked into in the last lecture. And once you know the N by N ratio, is for the Rn L, you can obtain the Rn L value, and then subsequently you can find out what is the total net radiation. So Rn L is the factor dependent on temperature, the factor dependent on AD, the factor dependent on N/N ratio, and the total net radiation can be now obtained by knowing these two quantities. I just mentioned that there can be a situation where you don't have these tables available, or you want to directly go in for equations, which if you are not doing this manually, you might like to have that in the equation form. This is an alternative equation which can give you the value of net long wave radiation. And this is in terms of the net outgoing clear sky long wave radiation, which is RNL 0, and RS 0 is the daily clear sky solar radiation at surface of Earth. Now these are the two quantities which are using the assumption that the sky is clear. That means there is no effect of the clouds. And knowing these two, RS is the solar radiation, the actual solar radiation which you are getting. So knowing these two quantities, you can find out, provided you have the empirical constants A and B, and these constants are available. We'll come to that. First, let's look at that RNL 0, which is the clear sky net outgoing long wave radiation. This is expressed n ton in terms of the eta, sigma, T maximum, and T minimum, whereas eta is the emissivity of the surface, which again you have. It is dependent on some further more parameters. We'll come to that. Sigma is the same sigma which you have seen earlier in one of the tables as the constant, is known as Stefan-Boltzmann constant, and its value is 4.8895 into 10 to the power minus 3 joules per square meter by Kelvin to the power 4. And Kelvin, as you know, is degree centigrade plus 273. Now, this emissivity in turn is dependent on the ESDP, which is the saturation vapor pressure at dew point. ESDP, we were discussing that in the last lecture. The dew point is a point on the cyclometric curve, and the corresponding vapor pressure will be the dew point vapor pressure, the saturation vapor pressure at the dew point. So that is deciding what is the emissivity. Now, in many situations, if you don't have the dew point, you can, and the relative humidity is quite high, then you can take the minimum temperature to be equivalent to the dew point temperature. And if you don't have that situation where the relative humidity is very high, the relative humidity is not very high, then this won't be possible. So in that situation, you can use another alternate relationship which uses the mean temperature instead to give you the value of emissivity. Okay. Well, that means that you have now all the relationships relationship which are needed to find out R and L. The only thing is that the, some of the constants which we have seen in these equations, they are not available. The coefficients A, B, A1 and B1. Now these coefficients are available in some of the areas. For USA, these are the coefficients which are available. For England, A and B is not available, but A1 and B1 are available. And in general, it has been seen that the approximate values, they can be approximated to these values for most of the other places. Although there will be some difference and some more work is needed by the scientists to obtain these values if these relationships have to be used. Because the present relationships which I have given you, they are obtained for some specific areas, and these values are the values which have been published and they are available. Maybe after some time, some more time, the other values will also become available. Now, okay, this is a relationship which, so as far as the net radiation is concerned, we have seen both the procedures. We have seen how we can use the FU recommended procedure and the tables which have been made available, and we can use those tables to find out how much is the net radiation value. So having having found out the net radiation, all the terms of the Penman equation are now known, except this C value, which is the conversion factor or the adjustment factor as we know it. This is the only value which we have not discussed so far. But before we discuss that, there's another relationship here which I wanted to bring into your notice. Now, this is the relationship between the relative humidity, the air temperature and the dew point temperature, which can be used in some situations where you want to get one quantity or the other, having known these quantities. In this, the T air is the dry bulb temperature, the T dew point is the dew point temperature, and RH is the relative humidity. Now, in this expression, if you want to get the maximum relative humidity, then you can replace the T air, the dry bulb temperature, with the minimum temperature. Okay, that will give you the maximum relative humidity, and vice versa. If you want to know what is the minimum relative humidity, you can use, instead of T air, that you can replace with the maximum temperature. So let's come to the adjustment factor. See, first of all, why this adjustment factor is needed? The Penman equation, as it was developed for some conditions which are the average conditions. For example, these are the major conditions which are used when the Penman equation was developed. Radiation is medium to high, so it was catering for the conditions when the radiation is between medium and high range. The RH maximum is between medium and high, and the daytime and the nighttime wind conditions are such that the ratio is around 2. So the moderate daytime wind is double the nighttime wind. So these were the set of conditions which were used And it was found that whenever some of these conditions change, the values which are obtained using the Feynman equations, they vary a lot. The inaccuracies which are incorporated, they are quite large. To account for those corrections, or to account for the variation in these factors when they are prevalent in the actual area, the C factor was devised, and this is a table which is recommended by the FAO. This table gives the C factors, and if you look at this part, it is having the RS and millimeters per day, and these are the RS values 3, 6, 9, and 12 for different RS, the solar radiation values. For RH maximum, this is RH maximum. This block gives the RH maximum of 30%, and this is on this side is the U day in meters per second, varies from 0 to 9. Now for these three combinations, for a given RH maximum, for a given RS, we have four different values, then you can interpolate, and for given U day, which is the wind velocity, the daytime wind velocity of from 0 to 9 meters per second, and another factor which is the U day U night ratio, and in this particular case this belongs to a ratio of 4. When the U day U night, or the wind conditions of day and night, their ratio is 4, then this part can be used. So for these four combinations, you have this part, and you can find out what is the value of C. Similarly, if the RH maximum changes, now here in the next one, everything else is same, but RS maximum is 60%. So the next one is 60%, the next one, the third one is with RH maximum of 90%. And likewise, the other segments are also given, where you have the RH maximum is this column 30%, but here U day U night ratio is 3, and this block, this is RH maximum 30%, this block is 60%, and this block is 90%. So you can use this table to find out what are the appropriate conditions in terms of RH maximum, in terms of the wind condition, the day and night wind ratio, wind speed ratio, and the RS, which is the prevalent RS on that particular day, and the day wind speed. This day wind speed is taken at 2 meters height again. So knowing these, you can evaluate what is the coefficient C which should be used. Now if you look at this table, you will find that whenever the conditions are closer to the ones which have been used when Feynman equation was derived, for example, in this particular case, you will find that in all the cases, the conditions, this particular area is having something closer to 1. So this is the RH maximum is 60% in this case. The U day and night ratio is around 3. If you look at the next one, when it's 2, we are still closer to 1. It's 0.99 and 1.05. So the conditions, these C values are very much different. They are, in this particular case, they are even 0.46, when the conditions are that you have the U day, the velocity is very high, as 9, and the relative humidity is very, the maximum relative humidity is very low. So in that case, a coefficient or a factor which is almost close to 50% that has been used, that means you are having a value, you are getting a value from the Penman equation which is very high. So it is over simulating the conditions, and that's why you need a factor to bring it down. So with that, we have seen in detail what are the various ways of calculating the reference drop evapotranspiration. There is only one more method, which is a different method, which is the pan evaporation method, which if I again bring out the old slide, we have covered these three methods. The fourth method was the pan evaporation method, in which you only needed the evaporation data and the data on the environment, at how the pan is, where the pan is situated, what is the environment closer to the pan, and you can use the data on the humidity and the wind if is available. Otherwise, you can use the estimated data. Let's look at the first of all, what is a pan? This is an instrument, is a very simple instrument, which is nothing but is a vessel which is a circular vessel, and the diameter there are different pans which are available in literature. In different countries, people are using various types of pans, but I'm trying to give you one pan which is quite popular, is known as U.S. Weather Bureau. Weather Service. Class A pan. As 121 centimeters in diameter, the depth is 25.4 centimeters. And what you do is that you fill this with water, and the depth up to which you normally fill the water, this depth should be maintained in such a way that the fluctuations are within around 5 to 7.5 centimeters from the rim of the pan. You can go maximum up to around 7.5 centimeters. So what you do is that you keep on pouring water regularly, the known quantities of water, so that you know that what is the depth. At that time, you keep a record of what was the depth at a particular time of the reading, when the reading was taken, what was the depth, how that depth has been depleting in time. That is what will give you that how much is the lost water because of evaporation activity. And then you again fill it up to the desired level. That means you are within this range, and again that process goes on. The stars, there are some requirements for placing the span, that it should be placed on some platform. There can be a wooden platform so that you are not. There can be a wooden platform on which you can place this, so that there is a lot of air which is passing through, and the ground surface temperature is not affecting the temperature of the water. But there are different types of pans. There are pans which are known as sunken pans, which are buried inside the ground, and there is a pan which is known as the Colorado sunken pan. There are pans which are even floated inside the lake, so you can have it on installed on a float. And what happens is that it depends where you are making the observations. Suppose if you are making an observation in the lake and you want to know what is the lake evaporation. Now if the lake is there, suppose you have this lake and you have installed the pan somewhere here. Now this pan is, this pan will be able to give you a reading which is much different than if you install the same pan on the ground, because of the fact that if the evaporation activity is taking place in the lake, then what you are getting here, the water vapors which are making this air saturated, that activity is much different, because now you can, with the knowledge which you have gained, you can see that this air will be very saturated. It will be having a lot of moisture available in its air mass. In comparison to this air, where you have only the water surface in this very small body, and there can be the wind which is regularly replacing this air mass which is somewhere in this area. Now with that replacement, this air is always the air which is over this particular pan will be much, much drier. It will be having much more absorption capacity. With the result, the evaporation which will be taking place from the pan on the ground will be much higher than the pan on the lake surface. So that variation can be there. You can you will find that depending on the type of the pan, depending on the environment, in this case this is what is the environment. The environment in this case is different, because one is inside the water body, the other one is on the land surface. Similarly, if there will be a situation where you have some cropped area here, this is having, the air is coming over the top of some cropped area, that will have its own impact on the evaporation activity at this place. So all these things will define the environment. But what we are looking at right now is that we are the FAO has assumed that they will be only considering that the pan in question is the US class A pan, and using that pan the relationships have been developed. So they have also given some conversion tables, that if you have some other pan, how you can convert, how you can use a factor which will convert the reading of that pan into an equivalent class A pan. This is the expression which is used to get the ET naught, the reference crop evapotranspiration, and as a function of E pan, there is the pan reading, there is the pan evaporation and millimeters per day, and it represents the the value over the period which you are considering. If you are considering a month, then what is the evaporation in millimeters per day over the month, the average value. And Kp is a pan coefficient which has to be used. This pan coefficient is a function of climate and the pan environment. This is a very simple equation, as we have in the other cases. The only question is that this is what we are observing. The E-pan is what we are observing in the observatories or wherever the pan is installed. Only Kp has to be evaluated, which needs some further information. Now, to incorporate the environment, to find out what is the environment, there are two cases which have been defined. One case, case A, in which this is the place where the pan is. In this case deals with that situation where you have the green crop on the windward side in the near immediate vicinity of the pan. So, there are relationships which have been developed to find out what will be the impact of this fetch of the green top. That means the extent can vary. If this varies, what will be the impact? So, there is one parameter, what is the fetch of the green top, which is then followed with the dry surface. And the other case is the other possibility, that if you have the pan installed in an area in which is having the green crop area, which is much away from the pan location, and in the near vicinity, in the immediate vicinity, the dry surface is available. How much is the extent of the dry surface? That is again is a variable which will be taken care of. But in both the cases, it has to be ascertained that the windward side has to be known, and the climate or the environment will be dependent on which is the windward side. Okay, if the windward side changes, your environment might change, because what happens? The wind direction is what is responsible for knowing whether the air mass which is coming over the pan or which is passing over the pan, what is the condition of that air mass? Because that is what is going to govern the activity of the evaporation. Now, having known these, then the Kp has been, this particular table is very small, so I'll try to explain what are the various variables which have been considered here. Now, to find out the Kp value from class A pan, that is the condition, this is the case for case 1 or case A. The various things which are considered here are, what is the value of RH mean in percentage? And there are three cases which are given: when RH mean is low, when is medium, and when is high. So, in the case of low, is less than 40%, what should be 70%, and greater than 70%. Then we have wind, which is expressed in kilometers per day. We have conditions which are the light wind, moderate, and strong, very strong. And we had covered these things in the beginning when we had looked at the nomenclature, that what are the various ranges when we talk of light. Light was less than 175, and the very strong was greater than 700 kilometers per day. Then another parameter which was introduced was the windward side distance of green crop, and meters. That's what we were saying, that this can be variable. So there are four different levels. When this is around 1 meter to 10 meters, 100, 1000. So these values now are the values of KP for the different levels: 0.65, 0.7, 0.75. Similarly, when it's very high, it's 0.75, 0.85, 0.85, 0.85. So in between you have the other values. Now this is what is given in this table. That's what this table is about. This table gives for case A all these KP values. Similarly for case B here, all these KP values for different fetch. Now this is the fetch in the case of case B, and again for the low, medium and high RS mean value, as well as for conditions which are light wind. Now this belongs to the light wind conditions. This belongs to the moderate wind, and the next one, strong wind, very strong wind. So you can use these for finding out what is the value of KP, and once you know the KP value, you can then find out what is the ET naught using the PAN equation. So with that, we have seen all the four methods. We have seen what are the various data requirements, how the method has to be used, what are the other assumptions used in using these methods. And with that, we close this particular section of the topic where we were trying to find out the ET naught, and we were trying to look at the effect of the climate on the crop water requirements. So we have only seen the first impact, that what is the impact of the climate on crop water requirements, and for that purpose we tried to define a reference crop, which is grass in the present case, though there is another crop which is alfalfa, which is also used for the reference purpose, as a reference crop. So is immaterial, because we said in the beginning that any crop which has which doesn't vary in its growth much, that can be used as reference crop. So in the next class we'll start with how we go to incorporate the effects of the crop characteristics into the crop water requirements, how we evaluate the crop water requirements. That is the remaining portion we'll look into. Any questions?